Well, hello there. Welcome to our production of The Importance of Being Earnest. But before we begin, I must tell you something. We have, perhaps quite wrongly, due to the convenient necessity of the nature of time, had to approach that plane slightly. Nothing to glare at. Anyways, I will act as a kind of narrator, shall we say, a helping hand, so that despite our omissions, things may continue smoothly. Now, if we continue this way, Bracknell. I hope you enjoy the show. Give me a second to get into character. And yeah.
How are you, my dear Ernest? What brings you up to town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else should bring anyone anywhere? Eating as usual, I see.
I believe it quite customary in good society to take some slight refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
In the country.
Well, what on earth do you do there?
Well, when one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It's excessively boring.
And who are the people you amuse?
Oh, neighbors, neighbors.
Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Huh? Shropshire? Yes, of course. Hello, why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young? Who's coming to tea?
Oh, merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolen.
Oh, perfectly delightful.
That is all very good, but I'm afraid Aunt Augusta won't quite enjoy your being here.
What do you say that for?
Well, my old boy, the way you flirt with Gwendolen is perfectly disgraceful. It's almost as bad as the way Gwendolen flirts with you.
I am in love with Gwendolen. I have come to town to propose to her.
I thought you said you'd come up here for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are.
I really don't see anything that romantic in proposing. It's very romantic to be in love, but there's nothing romantic about a definite proposal. The very essence of romance is uncertainty. But please don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They're ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
You've been eating them all this time.
She is my aunt. But, well, have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is for Gwendolen. She is quite devoted to bread and butter.
Very good bread and butter it is, too.
Well, my dear fellow, you need not eat as if you were going to eat at all. You behave as if you were married to her already, and I dare say you will never be.
What do you say that for?
Well, first off, women never marry the men they flirt with.
That is nonsense.
And secondly, I do not allow it.
You don't allow it?
Yes, my dear fellow. Gwendolen is my first cousin, and before I allow you to marry her, you will have to clear up the whole question of Cecily.
What do you mean, Algie, by Cecily? I don't know anyone of the name Cecily.
Lane, bring me that cigarette case Mr. Worthing left last time he dined here.
Do you mean to say you have had my cigarette case all this time? I wish to goodness you would let me know. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
I wish you would offer one. I seem to be more than usually hard up.
There is no use offering a reward now that the thing is found.
I think that is rather mean of you, Ernest, I must say. But it makes no matter, for when I look at the inscription inside, I find the thing isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times. And you have no right whatsoever to read what is written inside. It's a very ungentlemanly thing to read a private cigarette case.
Well, it is absurd to have hard and fast rules about what one should read and what one shouldn't.
I'm quite aware of the fact. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case was given as a gift from somebody of the name of Cecily. And you said you didn't know anybody by that name.
Well, if you must know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes. Charming old lady she is, too. Lives at Tunbridge Wells. Just give it back to me, Algie!
Yes, but why does she call herself Little Cecily if she is your aunt and lives at Tunbridge Wells? From Little Cecily, with her fondest love, to her dear Uncle Jack. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It's Ernest.
It isn't Ernest. It's Jack.
You have always said it was Ernest. I've introduced you to everybody as Ernest. You answer to the name of Ernest. You look as if you were Ernest. You are the most earnest-looking person I have ever saw in my life. It is perfectly absurd saying your name is not Ernest.
Well, my name is Ernest in town and Jack in the country. And the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that still does not explain the mystery of why your small aunt Cecily calls you her aunt. Better have the whole thing out at once.
Dear Algy, you know, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It's perfectly vulgar to talk like a dentist when one isn't a dentist. It produces a false impression.
Yes, that is exactly what dentists always do. Go on. Why are you Earnest in town and Jack in the country?
Produce my cigarette case first.
Now, produce your explanation. And pray, make it improbable.
Dear Algy, there is nothing improbable about my story at all. You see, old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a boy, made me, in his will, guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle out of a modicum of respect you could not possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country under the care of her incomparable governess, Miss Prism.
And where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You are not going to be invited. I may tell you quite candidly, the place is not in Shropshire.
I suspected that. I have Bunburyed all over Shropshire on two separate occasions. Now, go on. Why are you Earnest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear Algy, I don't know you'd be able to understand my motives. You're hardly too serious for that. You see, when one is put in the position of guardian, one has to take a very high moral stand on everything. It's one's duty to do so. And as a high moral stance can hardly be said to be conducive to either health or one's happiness, in order to get up to town, I have always pretended to have a younger brother of the name Ernest, who lives in the Albany and gets into the most dreadful scrapes. That, my dear Algy, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is rarely pure and simple. What you really are is a Bunburyist. I know one when I see one, and you are one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know.
What do you mean?
You have created a false brother by the name of Ernest that you may be able to come up to town as often as you like. I have invented a permanent invalid named Bunbury in order that I may go down to the country whenever I choose. Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. If it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, for example, I wouldn't be able to dine with you tonight at Willis's, for I really have been engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
I haven't asked you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You are absurdly careless about sending out invitations. It's very foolish of you. Nothing annoys people so much as not receiving invitations.
You would much better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I haven't the faintest idea of doing anything of the kind. Once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. Besides, now that I know you to be a Bunbury, I naturally want to talk with you about Bunbury. I want to tell you the rules.
I'm not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolen accepts me, I'm gonna kill my brother. Indeed, I think I'll kill him in any case. Cecily's a little too interested in him. And I strongly advise you to do the same with your, Mr. Invalid with the absurd name.
Nothing will induce me to part with Bunbury. Every man should be glad to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time.
That is nonsense. If I marry Gwendolen, and she is the only girl in the world who I would marry, I certainly won't want to know Bunbury.
Then your wife will. You don't seem to realize that in married life, three is company and two is none.
For heaven's sakes, don't try to be cynical. It's perfectly easy to try and be cynical.
My dear fellow, it isn't easy to be anything nowadays. Oh, that must be Aunt Augusta. Now, if I get her out of your way for 10 minutes so you can propose to her, would you invite me over to Willis's tonight for dinner?
I suppose so, if you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about meals. It is so shallow of them.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Good afternoon, dear Algernon. I trust you are well.
I'm feeling very well, Aunt Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two rarely go together.
Oh, dear me, you are smart.
I'm always smart. Am I not, Mr. Worthing?
You're quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Well, I hope I'm not that. It would leave no room for developments, and I intend to develop in many directions.
I'm sorry if we are late, Algernon, but I was obliged to call on dear Lady Harbury. I hadn't been down there since her poor husband's death. I never saw a woman so altered. She looks quite 20 years younger. And now I will have a cup of tea and one of those nice cucumber sandwiches you promised me.
Certainly, Aunt Augusta. Lane! Why are there no cucumber sandwiches?
There were no cucumbers in the market this morning, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for ready money.
That will do, Lane.
Thank you, sir.
I am greatly distressed, Aunt Augusta, about there being no cucumbers, not even for ready money.
It really makes no matter, Algernon.
I'm also sorry that I will inform you that I won't be able to be in your presence tonight.
I hope not, Algernon. It would put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs, though fortunately he's accustomed to that.
It is a great bore, and I hardly say a terrible disappointment to me, but the fact is, my poor friend Bunbury is very ill again. They seem to think that I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, Algernon, I believe it is high time your friend made up his mind whether he was going to live or to die. Illness is not a thing to be encouraged in others, and this modern sympathy with invalids is morbid. Health is the primary duty of life. I would consider it a great honor if your friend would be so kind as to not have a relapse on Saturday, for I require you to arrange my music.
Yes, I think I can still promise that I can ask him, if he is still conscious, but I think I can promise you he'll be all right by Saturday. Of course, the music is a great trouble. If you'll follow me to the next room, I'll show you the program that I've drawn up for the show.
Thank you, Algernon. I'm sure your program will be delightful after a few expurgations. Charming day it has been, Miss Fairfax.
Pray don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain they mean something else, and that makes me so nervous.
I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I'm never wrong.
And I would like to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary absence.
I would certainly advise you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back suddenly into a room that I have had to speak to her about.
Miss Fairfax, ever since I met you, I have admired you more than any girl I have ever met. Since I met you.
Yes, I'm quite well aware of the fact. And I often wish that in public, at any rate, you had been more demonstrative. For me, you have always had an irresistible fascination. Even before I met you, I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals, and my ideal has always been to love someone of the name of Earnest. There is something in that name that inspires absolute confidence. The moment Algernon first mentioned to me that he had a friend called Earnest, I knew I was destined to love you.
You really love me, Gwendolen?
Passionately.
Darling, you don't know how happy you've made me.
My own Earnest.
But you don't mean to say you couldn't love me if my name wasn't Earnest.
But your name is Earnest.
Yes, I know it is. But supposing it was something else, do you mean to say you couldn't love me then?
That is merely a metaphysical speculation. And like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference to the actual facts of life as we know them.
Well, really, Gwendolen, to be perfectly frank, I don't think much of the name Earnest. I don't think the name suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has music of its own. It produces vibrations.
Well, really, Gwendolen, I think there are lots of other much nicer names. I think Jack, for instance, is a charming name.
Jack? No. There is very little music in the name Jack, if any at all indeed. It does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. I've known several Jacks, and they all, without exception, were more than usually plain. The only really safe name is Earnest.
Gwendolen, I must get christened at once. I mean, we must get married at once.
Married, Mr. Worthing?
Well, surely. You know that I love you, and you led me to believe, Miss Fairfax, you were not absolutely indifferent to me.
I adore you, but you haven't proposed to me yet. Nothing at all has been said about marriage.
Well, may I propose to you now?
I think it would be an admirable opportunity. And to spare you any possible disappointment, Mr. Worthing, I think it only fair to tell you quite frankly beforehand that I am fully determined to accept you.
Gwendolen!
Yes, Mr. Worthing. What have you got to say to me?
You know what I've got to say to you.
Yes, but you don't say it.
Gwendolen, will you marry me?
Of course I will, darling. How long have you been about it? I'm afraid you have very little experience in how to propose.
My own one, I never loved anyone in the world but you.
Yes, but men often propose for practice. What wonderfully blue eyes you have, Ernest. They are quite, quite blue. I hope you will always look at me just like that, especially when there are other people present.
Mr. Worthing!
Rise, sir, from this semi-recumbent position. It is most indecorous.
Mama, I must beg you, retire. Mr. Worthing has not quite finished yet.
Finished what, may I ask?
I'm engaged to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Pardon me, you are nothing of the kind. When you do become engaged, I, or your father, should his health permit him, will inform you of the fact. An engagement should come on a girl as a surprise, pleasant or unpleasant as the case may be. And now, Mr. Worthing, I have a few questions to put to you. Gwendolen, you will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama!
In the carriage, Gwendolen! Gwendolen, the carriage!
You may take a seat, Mr. Worthing.
I feel bound to tell you, Mr. Worthing, you are not on my list of eligible candidates. I am, however, prepared to register your name, if your answers are what a really affectionate mother requires. Are your parents living?
I have lost both my parents, Lady Bracknell.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthing, may be regarded as a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who was your father? He was evidently a man of some wealth.
I'm afraid to say I really don't know. Fact is, Lady Bracknell, I said I had lost both my parents. It'd be nearer to the truth to say my parents seem to have lost me. I was found.
Found?
Yes. The late Mr. Thomas Cardew, an old gentleman of a very kind and charitable disposition, found me. And gave me the name of Worthing, because he happened to have a ticket for Worthing in his pocket. Worthing is a place in Sussex. It's a seaside resort.
And where did this gentleman with a ticket for a seaside resort in his pocket find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, Lady Bracknell, I was in a large, black leather handbag with handles to it. Ordinary handbag, in fact.
Where did this Mr. Cardew find this handbag?
In the cloakroom at Victoria Station. It was given to him in mistake for his own.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
Yes, the Brighton line.
The line is immaterial! Mr. Worthing, I confess I am bewildered by what you have told me today. To be born, or at any rate bred, in a handbag, whether it has handles or not, seems to me to display a contempt for the very decencies of family life, which remind one of the worst excesses of the French Revolution. And I'm sure you know what that unfortunate event led to.
May I ask, then, what you would advise me to do? I need hardly say I would do anything in the world to ensure Gwendolen's happiness.
Make a definite effort to produce at any rate one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
Well, I don't see how I could possibly do that. I have the handbag at home. I can produce it at any moment. I really think that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What on earth has it to do with me? You can hardly imagine that Lord Bracknell and myself would allow our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel. Good morning.
Oh, for goodness sakes.
Don't play that ghastly tune, Algie! How idiotic you are!
Didn't everything go off all right, old boy? You don't mean to say that Gwendolen refused you?
As far as Gwendolen is concerned, we're engaged. You don't think there's any chance of her becoming like her mother in about 150 years, do you, Algie?
All women become like their mothers. That's their tragedy. No man does. That's his.
Is that clever?
It's perfectly phrased.
I am sick to death of cleverness. Everybody is clever these days.
I wish to goodness we had a few fools left.
Well, did you tell Gwendolen about Ernest?
My dear fellow, the truth isn't exactly the sort of thing one tells to a nice, sweet, refined girl. What extraordinary ideas you have about the way to behave to a woman.
Well, the only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her if she is beautiful, and to someone else, if she is plain.
That is nonsense.
What about your brother? What about the profligate Ernest?
Oh, before the end of the week, I shall have got rid of him. My poor brother Ernest is carried off suddenly, in Paris, by a severe chill. That gets rid of him.
But I thought you said that Miss Cardew was a little too much interested in your brother Ernest. Won't she feel his loss a great deal?
Oh, that's quite all right. Cecily is not a silly romantic girl, I am glad to say.
I would rather like to see Cecily.
I will take very good care you never do. She is excessively pretty, and she is only just 18.
Did you tell Gwendolen that you have an excessively pretty ward who's only just 18?
Oh, one doesn't blurt these things out to people, Algy. Cecily and Gwendolen are perfectly certain to be extremely great friends. I'll bet you anything you like that half an hour after they've met, they'll be calling each other sister.
Women only do that when they have called each other a lot of other things first. Now, come on. If we want to get a good table at Willis's, we must really go and dress.
Miss Fairfax.
Gwendolen, upon my word.
Algy, kindly turn your back. I have something very particular to say to Mr. Worthing.
Really? Gwendolen, I don't think I can allow this at all.
You always adopt strictly a moral attitude towards life. You are not quite old enough to do that.
Dear Gwendolen.
Ernest, we may never be married. From the expression on Mama's face, I fear we never shall. But although she may prevent us from becoming man and wife, and I may marry someone else, and marry often, nothing that she can possibly do can alter my eternal devotion to you. The story of your romantic origin is related to be my mamma with unpleasing comments, has naturally stirred the deeper fibers of my nature. Your Christian name has an irresistible fascination. The simplicity of your character makes you exquisitely incomprehensible to me. Your town address at the Albany I have. What is your address in the country?
The manor house, Woolton, Hertfordshire.
It may be necessary to do something desperate. I will communicate with you daily.
My own one.
How long do you remain in town?
Till Monday.
Good. Algy, you may turn around now.
Thanks, I've turned around already.
You may also ring the bell.
Will you let me see you to your carriage, my own darling?
Certainly.
I will see Miss Fairfax out.
Lane, a glass of sherry.
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow, Lane, I'm going Bunbury.
Yes, sir.
Cecily, surely such a utilitarian occupation as the watering of flowers is rather Moulton's duty than yours, especially when intellectual pleasures await you. Your German grammar is on the table. Pray open it at page 15. We will continue yesterday's lesson.
But I don't like German. It isn't at all a becoming language. I know perfectly well that it'll look quite plain after my German lesson.
Child, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. He laid particular stress on your German.
Dear Uncle Jack is so very serious.
Cecily, I am surprised at you. Mr. Worthing has had many troubles in his life. You must remember his constant anxiety about that unfortunate young man, his brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would invite that unfortunate young man, his brother, down here sometimes. We might have good influence on him, Miss Prism.
I'm not in favor of this modern mania for turning bad people into good people at a moment's notice. You must put away your diary, Cecily. I don't see why you should keep a diary at all.
I keep a diary to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I should probably forget about all of them.
Memory, dear Cecily, is in the diary that we all carry about with us.
Yes, but it usually chronicles the things that never or couldn't possibly have happened. I believe that memory is responsible for nearly all the 3-volume novels that Muddy sent us.
Do not speak slightingly of the 3-volume novels, Cecily. I wrote one myself in earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Frism? How wonderfully clever you are. It did not end happily, I suppose. I do not like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
The good ended happily, the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means.
I suppose so. But it seems rather unfair, doesn't it? And was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript was unfortunately abandoned. I use the word in the sense of lost or mislaid. To your work, child, these speculations are profitless.
But I see dear Dr. Chasuble coming through the garden.
Dr. Chasuble, this is indeed a pleasure.
And how are we this morning? Miss Prism, you are, I trust, well?
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her so much good to have a walk in the park with you, Dr. Chasuble.
Cecily, I've not mentioned anything about a headache.
Yes, I knew that, dear Miss Prism. But I felt rather instinctively that you had one. In fact, I was thinking about that, and not my German lesson when the rector came in.
I hope, Cecily, you are not inattentive.
I'm afraid I am.
Oh, that is strange. Were I fortunate to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically, my metaphor was drawn from B's. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from town yet?
We do not expect him till Monday afternoon.
I must not disturb you both any longer.
I think, dear doctor, that I will have a stroll with you. I find I have a headache after all, and a walk might do it good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism, with pleasure. We may go as far as the schools and back.
That would be delightful. Cecily, you will read your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the fall of the rupee, you may admit. It is somewhat too sensational.
Horrid political economy. Horrid geography. Horrid German.
Mr. Ernest Worthing has just driven over from the station. He has brought his luggage with him.
Uncle Jack's brother. Did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Yes, miss. He seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you and Miss Prism were in the garden. He said he was anxious to speak with you privately for a moment.
Ask Mr. Ernest Worthing to come in here. I suppose you better arrange a room for him as well.
Yes, miss.
I've never met a really wicked person before. I feel rather frightened. I'm so afraid to look like everyone else. He does.
You must be my small cousin Cecily, I'm sure.
I'm afraid you're under some strange mistake. I am not little. In fact, I'm more than usually tall for my age. But yes, I am your cousin Cecily, and you are my cousin Ernest. My good cousin Ernest.
Oh, I am not wicked! You must not think that I'm wicked!
If you are not, then you've certainly been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. I hope you've not been leading a double life, pretending to be wicked, but being really good all the time.
Oh, I suppose I have been rather bad.
I'm glad to hear it.
Well, to qualify it, I've been bad in my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that, but... must have been rather pleasant.
It's much pleasanter being here with you.
I can't understand how you're here at all. Uncle Jack won't be back till Monday afternoon.
That is a great disappointment.
I think you'd better wait till Uncle Jack arrives. Besides, I know he wants to speak to you about your emigrating.
About my what?
Your emigrating? Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'd sooner die!
Well... at dinner at Wednesday night, Uncle Jack said you'd have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Well, the accounts that I've had of next world and Australia have not been particularly favorable. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid I'm not that. That is why I want you to reform me. You might make that your mission, if you don't mind, Cousin Cecily.
I'm afraid I've no time this afternoon.
Well, would you mind my reforming myself this afternoon?
It's rather quixotic of you, but I think you should try.
I will! I feel better already.
You're looking rather worse.
Well, that is because I'm hungry.
Oh, excuse me. I forgot that when one is trying to lead an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come in?
You should get married, dear Dr. Chasuble. You are too much alone.
The precept as well as the practice of the primitive church was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church has not lasted up to the present day. And you do not seem to realize, dear doctor, that but by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent public temptation.
But is a man not equally attractive when married?
No married man is ever attractive except to his wife.
And often, I've been told, not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can be depended upon. Ripeness can be trusted. Young women are green. I spoke horticulturally, my metaphor was drawn from the fruits. But where is Cecily?
Perhaps she followed us to the schools.
Mr. Worthing, this is indeed a surprise. We did not look for you till Monday afternoon.
I have returned sooner than expected. Dr. Chasuble, I hope you are well.
Dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of woe does not betoken some terrible calamity.
My brother.
More shameful debts and extravagance.
Still leading his life of pleasure?
dead.
Your brother Ernest, dead.
Quite dead.
What a lesson for him. I trust he'll profit by it.
Mr. Worthing, I offer you my sincere condolence. You have at least the consolation of knowing that you were always the most generous and forgiving of brothers. Were you with him in the end?
No, he died abroad. In Paris, in fact, I received a telegram from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
Was the cause of death mentioned?
A severe chill, it seems.
As man sows, so let him reap.
Charity, dear Miss Prism, charity. None of us are perfect. Will the interment take place here?
No. He seems to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
In Paris? I fear that hardly points to any very serious state of mind at the last.
Dr. Chasuble, I suppose you know how to christen. I mean, you are, of course, continually christening, aren't you?
But is there any particular infant in whom you are interested in, Mr. Worthing? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, was he not?
Oh, yes.
People who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
But it is not for any infant, dear doctor. No, the fact is, I would like to be christened myself. This afternoon, if you have nothing better to do.
But surely, Mr. Worthing, you have been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it.
But have you any grave doubts on the subject?
I certainly intend to have. That is, if you do not object, or if you do not think I am a little too old now.
Not at all. At what hour do you wish the ceremony be performed?
Would 5:30 do?
Admirably, admirably. Do? And oh, dear Mr. Worthing, I must not intrude any longer into a house of sorrow.
Uncle Jack, oh, I'm pleased to see you back. Horrid clothes have you got on. Do go and change them.
Cecily!
Do Uncle Jack look happy? Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother.
Who?
Your brother Ernest. He arrived 30 minutes ago.
What?!
These are very joyful tidings.
After we had all been resigned to his loss, his sudden return seems to me particularly distressing.
My brother is in the dining room? I don't know what it all means. Good heavens.
Brother John, I have come down from town to tell you that I am very sorry for all the trouble I have made, and that I intend to lead a better life.
Uncle Jack, you're not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to take his hand. He knows perfectly well why.
Uncle Jack, do be nice. There's some good in everyone. Ernest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury, who goes to visit so often.
Oh! He's been talking to you about Bunbury, has he? Well, I won't have him talk to you about Bunbury or anything else. It's enough to drive one perfectly
crazy. Of course, I admit all the faults were on my side, but I must say that Brother John's coldness to me is particularly painful. I expected a more enthusiastic welcome.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake Ernest's hand, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never, never, never.
Well, this shall be the last time I ever do it.
It's pleasant, is it not, to see so perfect a reconciliation? I think we may leave the two brothers together.
Cecily, you will come with us.
Don't leave, Miss Prism. My little task of reconciliation is over.
You've done a beautiful action today, dear child.
We must not be premature in our judgments.
You young scoundrel. Algy, you must leave this place immediately. I don't allow any bunburying here.
I've put Mr. Ernest's things in the room next to yours, sir. I suppose that is all right?
What?
Mr. Ernest's luggage, sir.
I'm afraid that I can't stay more than a week.
Please go order the dog cart. Mr. Ernest has been suddenly called back to town.
Yes, sir.
Cecily is a darling.
You are not to talk of Miss Cardew like that. I don't like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. You look perfectly ridiculous in them. Why don't you go up and change? I certainly won't leave as long as you're in mourning. It would be most unfriendly.
Well, will you go if I change my clothes?
Yes, if you are not too long. I never saw anyone take so long to dress and with such little result.
That is better than being always as immensely overdressed as you.
If I am, I make up for it. By always being always immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous, your conduct is an outrage, and your presence in my garden is absolutely absurd. I hope you will have a pleasant journey back to town.
Amalya came back to water the roses. I thought you were with Uncle Jack.
He's gone to fetch the dog cart for me. He's going to send me away.
Then have we got to part?
I'm afraid so. It's a very painful parting.
Yes. It's always very painful to part from one whom one has known for such a short period of time. The absence of friends one can endure with equanimity, but even such a momentary separation such as this one, it's almost unbearable.
Thank you. I hope, Cecily, I shall not offend you if I state quite frankly and openly that you seem to me to be in every way the visible personification of absolute perfection.
I think your frankness suits you well, Ernest. If I may, I will copy your remarks into my diary.
Do you really keep a diary? I'd give anything to look at it. May I?
Oh, no. You see, it is simply a young girl's record of her own thoughts and reflections, and consequently meant for publication. When it comes out in volume form, I do hope you will buy it, Ernest. But pray, don't stop. I'd like to take down from dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. Do go on. Oh, don't cough, Ernest. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently and not cough. Besides, I don't know how to spell cough.
Cecily, ever since I first looked upon your wonderful and incomparable beauty, I have dared to love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly.
I don't think you should say that you love me wildly, passionately, devotedly, and hopelessly. Hopelessly doesn't make much sense, does it?
Oh, Cecily.
The dog cart is waiting, sir.
Tell it to come around next week at the same hour.
Uncle Jack would be very much annoyed if he knew you were staying around till same time next week.
Oh, I don't care about Jack. I don't care about anybody in the entire world but you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
Of course. Well, we have been engaged for the last 3 months.
For the last 3 months?
Yes. It will be exactly 3 months on Thursday.
But how did we become engaged?
Well, ever since Uncle Jack confessed to us that he had a younger brother who was very wicked and bad, you have formed the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. I dare say it was foolish of me, but I fell in love with you, Ernest.
Darling, and when was the engagement actually settled?
On the 14th of February last. Worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence, I determined to settle the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you under this dear oak tree here. But this little ring in your name.
Did I give you this? It's very pretty, isn't it?
Yes. You've wonderfully good taste, Ernest. It's the excuse I always give you for leading such a bad life. This is the box where I keep all of your dear letters.
But, my own sweet Cecily, I've never written you any letters.
You need hardly remind me of that, Ernest. I know only too well I was forced to write your letters for you. I always wrote 3 times a week, sometimes oftener.
Oh, do let me read them, Cecily.
Oh, I could. They'd make you far too conceited. The 3 you wrote to me after I'd broken off the engagement are so beautiful and so badly spelled that I can hardly read them without crying.
But was our engagement ever broken off?
Of course it was. On the 22nd of March. You can see the entry if you like. You can. Today I broke off the engagement with Ernest. I feel it is better to do so. The weather still continues charming.
Cecily! I'm very much hurt indeed to hear that you broke it off, particularly when the weather was so charming.
It would hardly have been a really serious engagement if it hadn't been broken off at least once. But I forgave you before the week was out.
What a perfect angel you are, Cecily.
You dear sweet boy. I hope your hair curls naturally.
Yes, darling, with a little help from others.
I'm so glad.
You'll never break off our engagement again, Cecily.
I don't think I could break it off now that I've actually met you. Besides, there is the question of your name.
Yes, of course.
You must not laugh at me, darling, but Ever since I was young, it's always been a girlish dream of mine to love someone whose name was Earnest. A name that seems to inspire absolute confidence.
But, my dear child, do you mean to say that you could not love me if I had some other name?
But what name?
Oh, any name you like. Algernon, for instance.
But I don't like the name Algernon.
Can't really see why you should object to the name of Algernon. Seriously, Cecily, if my name was Algy, couldn't you love me?
I might respect you, Earnest, admire your character, but I fear that I should not be able to give you my undivided attention.
Cecily, your rector here is, I suppose, thoroughly experienced in all the rites and rituals of the church.
Oh, yes. Dr. Chasuble was a most learned man.
I must see him at once on a most important meeting.
Oh.
I shan't be away more than half an hour.
Considering that we've been engaged since February the 14th, and I only met you today for the first time, I think it is rather hard that you should leave me for so long a period as half an hour.
I'll be back in no time.
What an impetuous boy he is. I like his hair so much. I must enter his proposal in my diary.
Why, hello again. I'm sorry to interrupt the production. I hope you're enjoying it. But I've just realized we have a slight continuity issue, so we have to move some things around. Please bear with us. I don't think we need this anymore, right? Yeah, I think it's all good now. Miss Fairfax has just called to see Mr. Worthing on very important business, Miss Fairfax states.
Press the lady to come out here. Mr. Worthing is sure to be back soon. And you can bring tea.
Yes, miss.
Pray, let me introduce myself. My name is Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew, what a very sweet name. Something tells me we are going to be great friends. I like you already more than I can say, and my first impressions of people are never wrong.
How nice of you to like me after we've known each other for such a comparatively short time. Pray, sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will always call me Gwendolen, won't you?
If you wish.
Well, then that is quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
Now might be a favorable opportunity of mentioning who I am. My father is Lord Bracknell. You have never heard of Papa, I suppose?
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, Papa, I'm glad to say, is entirely unknown. Cecily, Mama, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be extremely short-sighted. It's part of her system. So do you mind my looking at you through my glasses?
Oh. Not at all, Gwendolen. I'm very fond of being looked at.
You are here on a short visit, I suppose?
Oh, no. I live here.
Really? Your mother, some relative of advanced years, resides here also?
Oh, no. I have no mother, nor in fact any relations.
Indeed?
Yes. My dear guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has the arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Worthing's ward.
Oh! Strange that Mr. Worthing never mentioned to me that he had a ward. How very secretive of him. I'm not sure, however, that the news inspires me with feelings of unmixed delight. Cecily, I like you very much. I've liked you ever since I've met you. But now that I know that you are Mr. Worthing's ward, I'm bound to state that I wish you were... well, just a little older than you seem to be. Not quite so very alluring in appearance. In fact, if I might speak candidly...
Oh, pray do. I really, whenever I have anything pleasant to say, one should always be quite candid.
Well, to speak with perfect candor, Cecily, I wish you were fully 42 and more than usually plain for your age. Earnest has a strong, upright nature. His very soul of truth and honor. Disloyalty would be as impossible to him as is deception. But even men of the noblest possible character are extremely susceptible to the physical influence of the charms of others.
I'm sorry, Gwendolen. Did you say Earnest?
Yes.
Oh, but it's not Mr. Earnest Worthing who is my guardian. It's his brother, his elder brother.
Earnest never mentioned to me that he had a brother.
I'm sorry to say that I haven't been on good terms for a long while.
That accounts for it. Cecily, you have lifted a load from my mind. I was growing almost anxious. It would have been terrible if any cloud had come across friendship like ours, would it not? Of course, you are quite sure that it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is your guardian?
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be his.
I beg your pardon?
Gwendolen, there's no reason I should keep it from you. Mr. Ernest Worthing and I are engaged to be married.
I'm afraid there might be some mistake. Mr. Ernest Worthing is engaged to me.
I'm afraid it must be a misconception. Ernest proposed to me 10 minutes ago.
It is very strange indeed, for he asked me to be his wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. If you would care to verify the incident, pray do so. I never travel without my diary. One should always have something sensational to read in the train. I am so sorry, dear Cecily, if it is any disappointment to you, but I'm afraid that I have the prior claim.
It would distress me more than I can say, dearest Gwendolen, if it caused you any mental or physical anguish. But I feel bound to point out that since Ernest proposed to you, he clearly has changed his mind.
If the fellow has been entrapped into any foolish promise, I shall consider it my duty to rescue him at once, and with a firm hand.
Whatever, poor, innocent, poor, unfortunate boy has gotten into, I will never reproach him for it after we are married.
Do you allude to me, Miss Cardew, as an entanglement? You are presumptuous. On an occasion of this, it becomes more than a moral duty to speak someone's mind. It becomes a pleasure.
I see no reason to call a shallow mask of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade.
I am glad to say that I have never seen a spade. It is quite clear that our social spheres have been widely different.
Shall I lay the tea here as usual, miss?
Yes, as usual.
Lovely garden, Miss Cardew.
So glad you like it, Miss Fairfax.
I had no idea there were any flowers in the country.
Well, flowers are as common here, Miss Fairfax.
Personally, I cannot understand how anybody manages to exist in the country. If anybody who is anybody does. The country always bores me to death.
May I offer tea, Miss Fairfax?
Thank you. Detestable girl, but I require tea.
Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar is not fashionable anymore.
Cake or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best houses nowadays.
And that to Miss Fairfax.
You have filled my tea with lumps of sugar, and though I'm asked most distinctly for bread and butter, you have given me cake. Now, I am known for the gentleness of my disposition and the extraordinary sweetness of my nature, but I warn you, Miss Cardew, you may go too far.
Does my poor, innocent, trusting boy from the machinations of any other girl? There's no length to which I would not go.
From the moment I saw you, I distrusted you. I felt you were false and deceitful. I'm never deceived in such manners. My first impressions of people are invariably right.
It seems to me, Miss Fairfax, that I am trespassing on your valuable time. No doubt you have many other calls of a similar nature to make in the neighborhood.
Ernest, my own Ernest. A moment. May I ask if you're engaged to be married to this young lady?
Dear little Cecily, of course not. What could have put such an idea in your pretty little head?
I knew there must be some misconception, Miss Fairfax. The gentleman over there is my guardian, Mr. John Worthing.
I beg your pardon?
That is Uncle Jack.
Jack? Oh.
Here is Ernest.
My own love.
A moment, Ernest. May I ask you, are you engaged to be married to this young lady?
To what young lady? Good heavens, Gwendolen!
Yes, to good heavens, Gwendolen.
Of course not. What could have put such an idea in your pretty little head?
I felt there was some slight error, Miss Cardew. The gentleman who is standing next to you is my cousin, Mr. Algernon Moncrieff.
Algernon Moncrieff? Oh. Are you called Algernon?
I cannot deny it.
Is your name really John?
I could deny it if I liked. I could deny anything if I liked, but my name certainly is John. It has been John for years.
A gross deception has been practiced on both of us.
My poor wounded Cecily.
My sweet wronged Gwendolen.
You will call me sister, will you not?
There's just one question I would like to be allowed to ask my guardian.
An admirable idea. Mr. Worthing, there's just one question I would like to be permitted to put to you. Where is your brother Ernest? We are both engaged to be married to your brother Ernest, so it is a matter of some importance to us to know where your brother Ernest is at the present.
Gwendolen, Cecily, it is very painful for me to be forced to speak the truth. However, I will tell you quite candidly that I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all.
No brother at all?
None.
I'm afraid it's quite clear, Cecily, that neither of us engaged to be married to anybody.
It's not a very pleasant position for a young girl to find herself in, is it?
Let us go into the house. They will hardly venture to come after us there.
No, men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This ghastly state of affairs is what you would call bunburying, I suppose?
Yes, and a perfectly wonderful bunbury it is. The most wonderful Bunbury I've had in my entire life.
The only small consolation I have in this whole wretched affair is that your friend, Mr. Bunbury, is quite exploded. You won't be able to go down to the country as often as you used to, dear Algy.
Your brother is a little off-color, isn't he, dear Jack? You won't be able to disappear to London quite so frequently as your wicked custom was. Not a bad thing, either.
As for your conduct toward Miss Cardew, I must say, your taking in a sweet, innocent girl like that is quite inexcusable, to say nothing of the fact that she is my ward!
I can see no possible defense at all for you deceiving a brilliant, clever, and thoroughly experienced young lady like Miss Fairfax, to say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin.
That's all! I love her!
Well, I simply wanted to be engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
There's certainly no chance of you and Cecily ever being united.
I don't think there is much likelihood, Jack, of you and Miss Fairfax being united.
How can you sit there, calmly eating muffins, when we are in this horrible trouble? I can't make out.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. The butter would probably get on my cuffs.
I say, it's perfectly heartless you're eating muffins at all under the circumstances.
Eating is the only thing that consoles me. Besides, I'm particularly fond of muffins.
Oh, I'm particularly fond of muffins. Well, that is no reason why you should eat them all in that greedy way.
But you've just said it is perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
I said it was perfectly heartless of you under the circumstances. That is quite a different thing.
That may be, but the muffins are still the same.
Algernon? I wish to goodness you would go.
You can't possibly ask me to go without having some dinner. It's absurd. I never go anywhere without my dinner. Besides, I have just made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 6:15 under the name of Ernest.
My dear fellow, the sooner you dispense with that infernal nonsense, the better. Besides, I made arrangements this morning with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 5:30, and I naturally will take the name of Ernest. Gwendolen would wish it. We can't both be christened Ernest, it's absurd. Besides, I have a perfect right to be christened if I like. You have been christened already.
Yes, but I have not been christened for
years.
Yes,
but you have been christened.
Yes, so I know my constitution can handle
it. That is nonsense. You are always talking nonsense.
Jack, do not touch this last muffin. I told you I was particularly fond of muffins.
Algernon! I have already told you to go. I don't want you here. Why don't you go?
I haven't quite finished my tea yet. And there's still one muffin left.
Ugh!
The fact that they did not follow us at once into the house seems to show that they have some sense of remorse left.
They're eating muffins. That seems like repentance.
They don't seem to notice us at all. Couldn't you cough?
But I haven't got a cough.
They're looking at us. What effrontery.
They're approaching. That's very forward of them.
Let's preserve a dignified silence.
Certainly. The most appropriate thing to do. Bum 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 bum
da 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 da. This dignified silence seems to produce a most unpleasant effect.
The most distasteful one.
But we will not be the first to speak.
Certainly not.
Mr. Worthing, I have a very important question to put to you.
Gwendolen, your common sense is invaluable. Mr. Moncrieff, kindly answer me the following question. Why did you pretend to be my guardian's brother?
In order that I may be able to see you.
That certainly seems like a satisfactory explanation, does it not?
Yes, dear, if you can believe him.
I do not, but I do not affect the wonderful beauty of his answer.
True. In matters of grave importance, style, not sincerity, is the vital thing. Mr. Worthing, what explanation can you offer me for pretending to have a brother? Was it in order that you might have an opportunity of coming up to town to see me as often as possible?
Can you doubt it, Miss Fairfax?
I have the gravest doubts on the subject, but I intend to crush them. Their explanations appear to be quite satisfactory, especially Mr. Worthing's. That seems to have the stamp of truth upon it.
Yes, I'm more than happy with what Mr. Moncrieff said.
So you think we should forgive them?
Yes. I mean, no.
True. There are principles at stake we cannot surrender.
Your Christian names are an insuperable barrier.
That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all?
But we are going to be christened this afternoon.
For my sake, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
I am.
Gwendolen, what does this mean?
Merely that I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Come here. Sit down. Sit down immediately. Apprised, sir, of my daughter's sudden flight by her trusty maid, whose confidence I purchased by means of a small coin, I followed her at once by a luggage train. You understand, of course, that all contact between you and my daughter must cease immediately. On this point, as indeed on all points, I am firm. I am engaged to be married to Gwendolen, Lady Bracknell. You are nothing of the kind, sir. And now, as regards Algernon. Algernon!
Yes, Aunt Augusta.
May I ask if it is in this locality that your friend Mr. Bunbury resides?
Oh, no, Bunbury does not live here. Bunbury is somewhere else at the moment. In fact, Bunbury is dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die? His death must have been extremely sudden.
Oh, I killed him this, he died this afternoon.
How did Mr. Bunbury die?
He was quite exploded.
Exploded? Was he the victim of a revolutionary outrage? I was not aware Mr. Bunbury was interested in social legislation.
By that, I mean he was, found out. The doctors found out that Bunbury could not live. That is what I mean. So, Bunbury died.
He seems to have had great confidence in the opinion of his physicians. I am glad, however, that he made up his mind at the last and pursued some definite course of action and acted under proper medical advice. And now that we have finally got rid of this Mr. Bunbury, Mr. Worthing, may I ask who is that young person my nephew Algernon has been looking at in that quite unnecessary manner? That lady is Miss Cecily Cardew, my ward.
I am going to be engaged to Cecily.
Mr. Worthing, is Miss Cardew at all connected with any of the larger railway stations in London? I merely desire information. Till yesterday, I had no idea there were any persons whose origin was a terminus. Miss Cardew is the granddaughter of the late Honorable Mr. Thomas Cardew of 104 Belgrave Square, Gervais Park, Dorking, Surrey, and the Sporran Fifeshire NB. That sounds not unsatisfactory. Three addresses always inspire confidence, even in tradesmen. So far, I am satisfied. Oh, how very kind of you, Lady Bracknell. I have also in my possession, you'll be pleased to hear, certificates of Miss Cardew's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles, both the German and English variety. Ah, a life crowded with incident, I see. Though perhaps too much for someone so young. As a matter of form, Mr. Worthing, I suppose I had better ask if Miss Cardew has any funds at all. Oh, merely £130,000 in the funds. So pleased to have seen you, Lady Bracknell. Goodbye. One moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000. And in the funds. Come here, sweet child. Pretty child. Your dress is sadly simple and your hair seems almost as nature might have intended it. But we can soon fix all of that. Turn around. No, the side view is what I want. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile. Algernon! There are distinct social possibilities in Miss Cardew's profile.
Cecily is the sweetest, dearest, prettiest girl in the whole world, and I do not care two pence about social possibilities.
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Algernon. Only people who can't get into it do that. My dear, I suppose you know Algernon has only his debts to depend upon. Well, I suppose I must give my consent.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
Cecily, you may sit down. The marriage, I think, had better take place quite soon. I am not in favor of long engagements. They give the couple the opportunity to learn each other's negative traits, which I think is never advisable. I beg your pardon, Lady Bracknell, but I am Miss Cardew's guardian, and she cannot marry until she comes of age, or otherwise without my consent. That consent I absolutely decline to give. Upon what grounds, may I ask? Algernon has nothing, but he looks everything. What more can one desire? The fact is, Lady Bracknell, I do not at all approve of your nephew and his character. I consider him to be, well, dishonest. I decline to give my consent. Cecily, how old are you?
I'm 18, but I really only admit to 20 at evening parties.
18, but admitting to 20 at dinner parties. Well, it will not be long before you are of age and free from your guardian's restraints. I see no reason why the marriage need not go forward. Pray, if you will pardon me for interrupting again, Lady Bracknell, but I feel it only fair to point out that, according to the terms in her grandfather's will, Miss Cardew does not come legally of age till she is 35. I think that is not too big of an obstacle. 35 is a very attractive age.
Algie, could you wait for me till I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You know I could.
Well, I felt rather instinctively that you could, but I could not. I hate waiting rather 5 minutes for
Then what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrieff.
Mr. Worthing, as Miss Cardew states, she cannot wait till she is 35, a remark which I am bound to say seems to show a somewhat impatient nature. I would beg of you to reconsider. But my dear Lady Bracknell, the matter is entirely in your hands. The moment you consent to my marrying Gwendolen, I will gladly allow my ward to form an alliance with your nephew. You must be aware that what you propose is quite impossible. Then, passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to. That is not the destiny I propose for Gwendolen. Algernon, of course, can choose for himself. Come, dear.
Everything is quite ready for the christenings.
The christenings, sir? Is not that somewhat premature?
Both these men have expressed desire for immediate baptism.
At their age? The idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. Lord Bracknell would be highly displeased if he learned that was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
Am I to understand that there'll be no christenings at all this afternoon?
I don't think, as it were, it would be of much use to any of us, Dr. Chasuble.
I'm grieved to hear such sentiments from you, Mr. Worthing. I will return to the church at once. Indeed, I've just been informed by the pew opener that for the last hour and a half, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry.
Miss Prism? Did I hear you mention a Miss Prism?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. I'm on my way to join her.
Pray allow me to detain you for a moment. Is this Miss Prism, a female of repellent aspect, remotely connected with education?
She is the most cultivated of ladies, the very picture of respectability. She's been for the last 3 years Miss Cardew's esteemed governess and valued companion.
It is obviously the same person. Let her be sent for.
She approaches. She is nigh.
Dr. Chasuble, I expect you in the vestry. I waited there for you nearly an hour and three quarters.
Prism! Come here, Prism. 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house, number 104 Upper Grosvenor Street, in charge of a perambulator containing in it a baby of the male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, thanks to the efforts of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered by itself, standing in a remote corner of Bayswater. In it was a manuscript of a 3-volume novel of more than usually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, I admit with shame I do not know. The plain facts of the case are these. On the morning of the day you mention, a day that will live forever in my mind, I prepared as usual to take the baby out in his perambulator. I had also with me a somewhat capacious handbag in which I intended to place the manuscript of a work of fiction that I had written during my few unoccupied hours. In a moment of mental abstraction for which I can never forgive myself, I deposited the manuscript in the bassinet and placed the baby in the handbag.
Where did you deposit the handbag?
Do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, please, this answer is very important to me.
One of the larger railway stations in London.
What railway station?
Victoria. The Brighton line.
I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolen, wait here for me.
If you are not too long, I will wait here for you all my life.
Is this the handbag, Miss Prism? Examine it carefully before you speak. The happiness of more than one life depends on your answer.
It seems to be mine. Here on the lock are my initials. I'm delighted to have it so unexpectedly restored to me.
Miss Prism, more is restored to you than that handbag. I was the baby you placed in it.
You?
Yes, mother!
Mr. Worthing, I am unmarried.
Unmarried? I do not deny that is a serious blow, but after all, who has a right to cast a stone against one who has suffered? Mother, I forgive you!
Mr. Worthing, there is some error. There is the lady who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell, I hate to seem inquisitive, but would you kindly inform me who I am? I'm afraid the news I have will not entirely please you. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrieff, and consequently Algernon's elder brother. Algernon's elder? Then I have a brother after all! I knew I had a brother! I always said I had a brother! Cecily, how could you have ever doubted that I had a brother? Algy, you young scoundrel! You will have to treat me with more respect. You have never behaved to me like a brother all your life!
Well, I'll try, my boy, but I must say I've been out of practice.
My own one. What is your Christian name now that you've become someone else?
Good heavens! I had forgotten that. Your decision on the subject of my Christian name is irrevocable, I suppose.
I never change, except in my affections.
What a noble nature you have, dear Gwendolen.
Then the question had better be cleared up at once. Lady Bracknell, a moment. At the time when Miss Prism placed me in the handbag, had I been christened already? Every luxury that money could buy, including christening, had been lavished on you by your fond and doting parents. Then I was christened. That much is settled. But now what name was I given? Let me know the worst. Being the eldest son, you were naturally christened after your father. Yes, but what was my father's Christian name? I cannot at the present moment recall what the general's Christian name was, but I have no doubt he had one. Algy, can't you recall what our father's Christian name was?
My dear boy, we weren't even on speaking terms. He died when I was a year old.
His name would appear in the, army lists, wouldn't it? Indeed it would.
Ah, the army lists of the last 40 years are here. These delightful records should have been my constant study. M, Generals, Magley, Maxbaum, Miggs, what ghastly names they have. Mark B, Miggs B, Mobs, Moncrieff. General, Lieutenant, 1840, 1830, Lieutenant Colonel, 1890, Generals, M, Moncrieff, Ernest? John.
I always told you, Gwendolen, that my name was Ernest, didn't I? Well, it is Ernest. After all, I mean, it naturally is Ernest. Yes, I remember now that the general was called Ernest. I knew I had some reason for disliking the name.
My own Ernest. I felt from the first that you could have no other name.
It is a terrible thing for a man to find out throughout his entire life he has been speaking the truth. Can you ever forgive me?
I can, for I feel you are sure to change.
My own one!
Letitia, at last!
Cecily, at last!
Gwendolen, at last. My nephew, you seem to be displaying signs of triviality. On the contrary, Aunt Augusta. I have now realized, for the first time in my life, the vital importance of being
Earnest.
Gwendolen, upon my word. Gwendolen, upon my word.
Algy, kindly tell us to get a fall off.
I walked into the tree.
I'm about to do that.
Importance.
Did you have it again? No. I think I ripped the dress even more.
What if I turn my face this way because I have to look?
That's fine, it's so fine. Ugly. You're not.
It's gonna be like so close up.
Like every single pore.
Yeah. I'll be like, oh, what a front tree.
You wanna play contact?
Contact,
sure.
A.
A?
Yeah, A.
It's not Amalya.
Contact. Wait, no proper noun.
Sorry, I'm the center of the universe, so.
He was in the shot the entire time.
Was he?
Yeah, he was back there.
It's fine.
Hey, wait. Shut up. She's an insufferable.
Okay.
Expressed immediate desire for baptism.
A desire for immediate baptism. Okay.
I'm so sorry.
Yes, she's very helpful.
Yes, she's gross.